Now let's see some examples to better understand this algorithm. First, let's examine the exploratory nature of Epsilon-Greedy. We've mentioned that Epsilon-Greedy incorporates exploration, but let's see how strong this exploration can be. First, consider the case where Epsilon equals 1, meaning that the policy has the strongest exploration ability. In this case, the policy essentially becomes a uniform distribution. In our example where each state has 5 actions, each action is assigned a probability of 0.2. Let's generate an episode based on the policy from here. If the episode consists of only 100 steps, we see that many states can be visited. With 1,000 steps, almost all states and their corresponding actions can be explored. With 10,000 steps, the states and actions can be visited many times. Now, let's examine how many times each state action pair is visited if the episode has 1 million steps. The x-axis represents the index of state action pairs, which totals 125, 25 states with 5 actions each. Each state action pair has been visited thousands of times, illustrating the thorough exploration achieved even with just one episode. This example clearly demonstrates that when Epsilon is large, exploration is strong, making exploring starts unnecessary. Therefore, instead of starting from every SA, we can visit all SA by starting from only one. Let's further enhance our understanding with a video demonstration of this process. This video demonstrates such a policy where an agent continuously explores within this environment according to the policy. The blue arrow represents the agent's current state and the action it has taken. Initially, it starts from this state and now finds itself trapped in this area. Since the surroundings are difficult to escape, yet it persists in exploration. Let us see if it can move out of this area. Now it has left this area, and due to a certain probability of choosing other places, it has moved to this new area. Because of its strong exploration ability, it has again moved to another side. Up to this point, almost all states have been visited, but some actions have yet to be explored. Let's see if it can eventually explore these actions as well. As we can see now, these actions have been explored too. Thus, this example demonstrates more vividly that its exploratory nature is quite strong. A single episode has indeed visited all states and actions. Another example has a relatively small value of epsilon. Naturally, the exploration ability of the policy is weaker compared to larger epsilon values. For instance, with 100 steps, we can observe, even though I have not plotted the Epsilon-Greedy policy here, that when the number of steps is relatively small, the agent visits fewer states because its preference is stronger. Even with 1,000 or 10,000 steps, there are still some actions that have not been visited. Even if the episode has 1 million steps, we notice that the frequency of visits is highly uneven. That is, some state actions are visited an extremely high number of times, while others are visited less frequently. But compared to a greedy policy, it still possesses a certain exploratory ability. Through the two examples just discussed, we see that the Epsilon-Greedy policy indeed has a certain level of exploratory ability. Now let's run the MC Epsilon-Greedy algorithm as follows and observe the resulting optimal policy. In the next example, we do the following in every iteration. I generate an episode using the current Epsilon-Greedy policy, but this episode is exceedingly long, consisting of 1 million steps. Then, I use this episode to update the action values corresponding to all state action pairs and also update the policy. Why do I do this? The purpose is to demonstrate that this algorithm indeed does not need the condition of exploring starts. As long as the episode is sufficiently long, even if it begins from a single state action pair, it can still visit all other state action pairs. Let's take a look at the results. This is the initial policy, which is clearly not optimal since it assigns the same probability to all actions in every state. Using such a policy to generate an episode of 1 million steps, I then updated the policy and obtained this new policy. This updated policy is still not optimal since it keeps staying still in some states. It is used to generate another 1 million step episode. After updating the policy again, I obtained this policy. If we look only at the actions with the highest probability in this final policy, it is relatively reasonable compared to the second one. At least starting from any point, it could reach the target, but it would pass through obstacles. Therefore, from this perspective, it is not optimal, since the optimal policy should navigate around obstacles to reach the target. In summary, the epsilon-greedy policy indeed gains some benefits from its exploratory nature, but at the cost of optimality. As discussed earlier, its advantage lies in strong exploration ability, yet its disadvantage is the sacrifice of optimality. In practice, we can balance this by setting a relatively small epsilon value. As epsilon approaches zero, an epsilon-greedy policy becomes closer to a greedy policy. Thus, the optimal epsilon-greedy policy found using this algorithm is close to the optimal greedy policy. In reality, we could also gradually decrease epsilon, starting with a larger value to gain strong exploratory ability and then reducing epsilon towards zero, ultimately achieving a policy that is optimal. Next, we use some other examples to illustrate the optimality of the epsilon-greedy policy. In this example, first, I present a policy and then solve its Bellman equation to obtain its state value. The epsilon corresponding to the first policy is equal to zero, making it a greedy and optimal policy. The state values corresponding to this policy are shown here. When examining the second policy provided, it's important to understand its relationship with the first. They are consistent. For example, the direction to move here is upwards in the first policy, and in the second policy, the highest probability here also leads upwards. However, the second policy assigns a smaller probability to other actions as well. This is called consistent. The state value calculated in this case is lower than the first. Why does this happen? That is because actions that are not good may be taken. Increasing epsilon decreases the state value, and when epsilon equals 0.5, many values have turned negative. State value is a metric for evaluating a policy. Our definition of an optimal policy is indeed based on the state value. The optimal policy is the one with the highest state value. Thus, we know that although all policies maintain consistency with the optimal greedy policy, their optimality downgrades. Let's check the target area. In the optimal policy, it holds the highest value. However, with a larger epsilon, it becomes negative, even the lowest. This shift occurs because there's a significant probability of entering forbidden areas, leading to a lot of negative rewards. Next, we will use the MC epsilon-greedy algorithm to solve some examples, and we will see an interesting property. First, here's the example. I directly give the optimal policy, which is greedy. This is the corresponding optimal state value. Then, applying the MC epsilon-greedy algorithm and setting epsilon to 0.1, what is the final outcome provided by this algorithm? It is this policy. This policy has a significant relationship with the optimal policy. They are consistent. As we mentioned earlier, they are consistent. In essence, for any state I choose here, for instance, if it is to move right here, then correspondingly in this policy, the highest probability is also to move right. Thus, they are consistent. This consistency is important because after obtaining the optimal epsilon-greedy policy with the MC epsilon-greedy algorithm, we intend to apply it in practice. In real-world applications, we will convert the epsilon-greedy policy into the corresponding greedy policy. And we hope that this greedy policy will match this optimal policy. When epsilon is set to 0.1, this hope becomes reality. Converting it to a greedy policy indeed yields the optimal greedy policy. However, when epsilon is set to 0.2, the resulting optimal epsilon-greedy policy no longer maintains consistency with the optimal greedy policy. If you convert it, they differ. Similarly, with epsilon set to 0.5, the resulting optimal policy is also not the optimal greedy policy. So, what does this tell us? It suggests that if you want to use the MC greedy approach, your epsilon cannot be too large. Alternatively, a trick is to start with a larger epsilon for stronger exploration at the beginning, and then gradually reduce epsilon to zero, eventually yielding an optimal policy. That concludes today's lecture. To be honest, recording this lecture has been the most time-consuming one I've ever worked on. I recorded many times to ensure clarity and coherence. I hope I have provided you with a clear introduction, reducing any potential confusion and ensuring a smooth learning experience. If you've reached here, it means you've completed the entire lecture. I genuinely hope it has been helpful to you. Now let's briefly recap the key points covered in this lecture. We began by introducing Monte Carlo methods through a motivating example, highlighting their application in estimating expectations from data without requiring a model. We then extended these concepts to reinforcement learning, presenting three related algorithms of increasing complexity and efficiency. Finally, we provided numerous examples to illustrate some properties of the Epsilon-Greedy policy. This concludes the content of our lecture. Thank you all, and see you next time.